Next session is AI and safety. So, Cho Sung-Bae, Yonsei University, Cheong Yun-Gyung from Sung-Kyung-Kwan University, and also Steve Wilson from Constellation Research Australia are on. I realized that it's better for the speakers sit in the audience while one of the speakers is presenting with a PowerPoint presentation. So let's start with Dr. Cho from Yonsei University. Come on up.
Hi, everyone. I am Sung-Bae Cho from Yonsei University. And so today, what I'm trying to talk about is the safety of AI, or AI for safety. And maybe that this morning, the Professor Jin-Young Kim already gave you the real nature of AI in practice. However, I just would like to give you the reality of the AI, because that AI sounds like something fantasy or something. But anyway, in practice, AI is not that does not reach that point. That is my point, actually. So part of one part of the talk is on giving the real nature of AI once again, and try to give you some of my thought about the AI safety in the latter part. So most of you are aware of AI from the SF movie or novels or something. That is quite amazing, and we can aware about safety as well. However, in reality, I cannot see any serious cause for concern that AI is a real threat to humankind. It's just a novel or movies. And also, as far as I know, there are no machines with self-sustaining long-term goals or intention. And of course, and moreover, that they are not likely to be developed in the near future. However, still, we are concerned about the AI. Instead, from my point that in the near future, there are increasingly useful applications of AI with a potentially profound positive impact on our society and economy are likely to emerge, especially for the safety. So what is AI? Actually, the AI is the field to study on the human intelligence itself and try to develop some systems based on that idea. And as you already know, that we are defining the AI in two different terms. For the ultimate goal is to develop the real AI, which can act just like human, for the creativity, thought, and emotions. However, we are trying to go that direction, but it's too difficult to get that point. And so far, we are just stuck in the weak AI to develop some systems or some technologies to solve specific problems like the human beings. And by succeeding with that direction, usually that we can develop some systems for the large scale data processing tirelessly and unbiasedly. And that is the good point for us. However, it is quite difficult to implement. Why? Because we don't know about intelligence and how we can make the intelligence. So from my point of view, that during the last 60 more years, that our history of AI is to try to find that good technique or best method to give us the solution for that question. So we are trying to study on logic, optimization, probability, search, etc. And in the previous, in this morning's talk, that you can already got that these techniques can be divided in two directions. One is based on knowledge-based, and the other one is data-driven AI. And later part is quite exciting, especially these days, because the machine learning can solve many interesting problems from the large number of data with the huge computing resources. So I would like to give you the reality of that, the current state of AI with a good example for each approaches. The first approach, the ultimate success of the AI system might be the IBM Watson, because that, I don't know anyone else, but in Korea that we are very big fan of IBM Watson because it can give us a lot of interesting solutions. However, that this system is mainly for solving the problem of quiz competition. So it is just famous for to win the human champions in Jeopardy quiz show in 2011. And however, how can he make it? Actually, it's just a complicated software. So in order to solve that, the deep Q&A, that we just developed a complicated process of matching that solutions from the questions and try to filter the potential candidate of the solutions one by one and finally get the final solution. That is the usual process of the software. However, as a result, we can get the amazing system which can defeat the human champions. And this is the one example of that knowledge-based approach of AI. And second approach is data-driven AI. And one of the successful AI system is the AlphaGo. Maybe you are aware of that. Actually, in Korean, we Koreans are very active, very cheerful, and many people are interested on this topic. And anyway, it is just a program to solve the problem of game Go. And also, as I mentioned before, the basic system is just a software. It is just a sophisticated software. The only thing different is to make the specific function, two functions actually, made by the data, a lot of data. And in order to estimate some model with a large number of data, we use the specific technique called deep learning. But deep learning is just another one of that complicated estimation method for machine learning. So there are many challenges in this area, and there are many potential solutions to integrate the many pieces of the AI techniques and softwares to develop the ultimate goal of the AI. But in this sense, the AI, we are just keen about the weak AI. Even though that many philosophers and cognitive scientists try to learn about AI, the strong AI, but there are big gaps between the reality and our goal. So the latter part is based on those background on the AI. What can be the issue about the AI and safety? So I just think about the two directions. Maybe the AI, we have to think about the safety of AI itself. And of course, and in the opposite direction of the utilizing AI for the better safety. Usually from my definition, that latter part might be much interesting and much influential. However, our main goal is that the first direction, the safety of AI. So I just divided that that direction is conscious regarding on conscious threat and unconscious threat. And the opposite direction is that many utilizing AI for the public safety and security. So this slide might be the highlight of my talk today, even though that I'm not a deliberative thinker, so it's a quite shallow level. But anyway, from my definition, that we have to consider about the conscious threat of the AI systems. Sometimes that some bad guy can utilize the AI to kill the people and to win the war or something. So there are many criminal threats utilizing the killer drones, and also many people are concerned about the laws. The lethal autonomous weapon systems, it is quite, it may cause the miserable result. And also, it is related with infringement of privacy and personal information. Maybe in order to solve some problems in this direction, we need more careful consideration of AI safety for critical applications by developing some new ethics, laws, regulations, and even some new technologies. However, on the other direction, we also concerned about the unconscious threat caused by AI systems, because that AI system is another software. So as you may know, that any software has bugs, and sometimes it is a malfunction. However, the AI system's malfunction is quite serious. For example, that for subway or airplanes might cause the mass casualties. So it's quite critical. And why does it cause? From my point of view, that it is mainly caused by the excessive dependence on AI because of that convenience, I think. By developing some systems based on the AI, the better AI, the more convenient for the people. So we try to develop some systems, complicated systems based on the AI. Then in some point, we can just lose our control to the AI systems. It is not just taken over or taken by the AI systems, just we give, endow our control or ability to the AI system. Then it may cause some serious problems. So in this direction, also we need some new rules and regulations and technologies, etc. Actually, that's the main point. And what I'm thinking is that the safety problem regarding the AI is mainly not in AI, but in people to develop the AI or utilize the AI. And the other direction might be a little bit different from the main theme of this this conference, and also the organizer just to try to speed up. So AI can be also utilized for the safety, because the cameras and drones and software to analyze the crime scenes can be used to reduce the human bias and enhance the safety and ultimate direction. And also, AI already solved many critical and interesting problems on safety, such as that credit card fraud detection. So AI tools can be used to manage the many interesting criminal problems. And also, AI can be used to get some greater accuracy on event classification and try to detect the anomalies automatically. Most of the things can be developed by knowledge-based approach or data-driven approach. However, at this moment of time, the machine learning, such as the deep learning, is just a better candidate. So there seems to be arms race between two directions, two approaches. And at this moment of time, the machine learning can be the right method to predict where and when crimes are more likely to happen and who may commit them. And maybe we can implement some sort of the minority report phenomenon. So in order to make the safer software, we need some software engineering practice at the developer level. However, develop the software, we need some library component. That is the usual direction to develop the software at this moment of time. However, it doesn't seem desirable to subject all the developers to the standard required for the most critical rare applications like AI systems. And nor does it seem advisable to allow unregulated use of such components in safety critical applications. So we need something to think about the trade-off between promoting the innovation and regulating for safety nicely. So my concluding remarks like this one, it's just a general opinion of that many people. So if we just think about AI primarily with fears and suspicion, then maybe missteps that slow AI's development, and it may cause much harm, much worse situations to the society. So my final concluding remark is, if society approaches AI with a more open mind, the technologies emerging from the field could profoundly transform society for the better in the coming decade. That is my point. Is it right? Thank you.
Next up, Professor Jung Yun-Gyung from Sungkyunkwan University, AI for Safe Online Game Chats.
Okay, my name is Yun-Gyung Cheong. I'm an assistant professor at Sungkyunkwan University. Today I'm going to discuss a concrete problem that AI helped the social safety for online game chat. I'm going to speak Korean, but I think that it's okay for English audience, English audience, no, for audience from other countries, because the slide tells a lot. So, okay, here, that's what I'm gonna tell. 우선 문제에 대해서 말씀드리고 접근 방법 그리고 여기서 제가 했던 이 과제에서 있었던 에티컬 이슈에 대해서 잠깐 디스커스를 하고요. 지금 하려고 하는 발표는 제가 2015년도에 발표했던 IEEE의 그 Computational Intelligence and AI in Games에 실렸던 그런 내용을 기반으로 하고 있습니다. 우선 여기 보시는 바와 같이 그 온라인 챗에서의 어떤 뭐 섹슈얼 프레데이션에 관련된 이런 행동들이 그 자주 일어난다는 것을 보실 수 있는데요. 2011년도에 있었던 EU Kids Online Research에 의하면은 8명 중에 한 명은 어린아이들을 대상으로 9살부터 16살 사이에 그랬을 때 8명 중에 한 명은 이런 성적인 메시지를 받아본 적이 있다라고 리포트를 하고 있고요. 저희가 이 연구를 하게 된 이유는 여기 MSP라고 되어 있는데 무비스타 플래닛이라는 게임 회사에서 저희 제가 있었던 그 당시에 제가 그러니까 2013년도에 제가 덴마크에 있는 IT 유니버시티 오브 코펜하겐에 있었는데요. 그때 저희 학교에서 약 100m 떨어진 곳에 이 무비스타 플래닛이라는 게임 회사가 있었어요. 그래서 그 회사가 저희한테 의뢰를 한 그런 내용입니다. 그 무비스타 플래닛은요, 이 온라인 소셜 게임인데요. 여기서 이 게임에서 주로 목적은 뭐냐면은 보시는 바와 같이 여기 이제 아이들이 무비스타를 아바타를 이제 키우는 거죠. 키워서 이 아바타를 데리고 이제 그 안에서 게임 월드 안에서 이제 온라인이 아니고 영상을 찍어요. 동영상을 찍어요. 그래서 아바타들을 데리고 동영상을 찍는데 그 영상이 스토리텔링이 좋고 하면은 이제 다른 유저들이 그 영상을 많이 보는 거죠. 그래서 그렇게 해서 포인트를 쌓아가는 그런 게임이에요. 대상은 주로 8살에서 15살 사이의 여자 어린아이들이 대상이고요. 보시기에는 조금 이게 뭐 많이 쓸까라고 생각을 하실 수도 있는데 그 회사 관계자 그때 저희가 같이 얘기했던 분은 그 회사의 CTO 분이셨는데 그분에 의하면은 이게 그 영국하고 미국에서 많이들 하기 때문에 100만 유저가 접속하는 동시 접속자 수가 한 100만 정도까지도 된다고 합니다. 그래서 그 회사의 문제는 뭐냐면은 이제 그 온라인 챗에서도 그런 섹슈얼 프레데터들이 있는 거죠. 그러니까 여기 주로 어린이들이 대상인데 그런 섹슈얼 프레데터들이 고의적으로 여기에 로그인 회원가입을 해서 그래서 어린애들을 꼬셔서 이제 더 큰 문제는 뭐냐면 그 안에서도 어떤 성적인 그런 채팅을 하지만 이게 오프라인에서 실제로 성폭행으로 일어날 수 있는 가능성이 있고요. 실제로 그 경찰을 한 두 번 정도 불렀다고 했어요. 그래서 그게 큰 문제가 됐기 때문에 가장 우려가 되는 부분이다. 이거 말고도 뭐 왕따 같은 거 있죠. 사이버 불리 그런 것도 있지만 가장 큰 문제는 바로 이거다라고 해서 저희가 이 문제에 대해서 연구를 하게 되었습니다. 잠깐 동영상을 잠깐 조금 이따 보여드릴게요. 그래서 이 회사가 이 부분에 대해서 많이 그 컨선이 있기 때문에 실제로 모더레이터들이 있어요. 휴먼 모더레이터들이 있어서 유저들이 이제 리포트를 하면은 그 모더레이터들이 그 내용이 정말로 프레데터에 속하는 거 아닌가를 보고서는 그에 합당한 어떤 벌칙을 준다던가 하는 그런 그런 어떤 대책 같은 거를 가지고 있습니다. 그리고 그 처음에 회원을 가입할 때 보면은 여기에 룰이 있다, 가이드라인이 있다. 여기를 넘어서면 자기네들이 뭔가 이렇게 뭐 블락을 한다거나 뭐 하루 뭐 일주일 한 달 블락을 한다거나 혹은 계정을 아예 없앨 수도 있다. 이렇게 그렇게 경고를 하고 있어요. 여기 보시면은 여러 가지 룰들이 많이 있고 그중에서도 주로 어떤 이 성적인 문제가 되는 그런 행동에 관련된 룰만 모아 놓은 건데요. 그래서 동영상 하나 보여드리면 이거는 저희가 모았던 동영상은 아니고요. 유튜브에서 제가 찾은 거예요. 근데 전체 화면을 할 수가 없네요. 지원하지 않습니다. 네. 그럼 그냥 한번 보여드리겠습니다. 보시면 이제 이 유저가 이런 채팅에서 이런 일이 일어났다. 보면은 뭐 그런 뭐 약간 섹슈얼한 내용을 얘기하고 있어요. 그래서 그걸 리포트하는 과정을 지금 찍어서 올린 거예요. 그래서 뒷부분에 가보면 이게 블락할 수 있는 리포트하고 블락할 수 있는 그런 UI도 제공을 하고 있어요. 그래서 이 중에 문제가 되는 행동이 어떤 카테고리에 속하느냐 이렇게 이렇게 선택을 해서 신고할 수 있도록 그런 UI도 제공을 하고 있습니다. 그래서 계속해서 이제 우선 이런 행동이 걸리면 처음에는 경고를 주고 그 다음에는 일정 기간 동안 블락을 하고요. 이제 최악의 경우는 그 계정을 삭제하는 그런 행동을 하고 있는데요. 그래서 저희가 이 문제를 처음에 이제 의뢰를 받고서 그리고 시작을 할 때 섹슈얼 프레데터를 뭐라고 정의하느냐부터 시작을 했는데요. 그러니까 사실 섹슈얼 프레데터는 뭐 성적인 그런 언어를 쓰는 사람이라고 생각하면 간단하지만 실제 그 데이터를 보니까 어떤 경우가 있냐면은 그런 그 한 사람 A라는 사람이 그런 성적인 메시지를 시작을 했는데 B라는 사람이 거기에 동조하는 경우가 있어요. 이 경우는 사실 A라는 사람이 뭐 완전히 프레데터라고 보기는 힘들죠. 그냥 두 사람이 어떻게 보면 자유의지로 그런 채팅을 한 거라고 볼 수도 있어요. 그렇지만 이 저희는 기계 AI이기 때문에 얘가 어떤 경우가 뭐 그런 의도 그러니까 서로 양쪽에 뮤추얼한 그런 관계인지 어떤 경우가 아닌지 알 수가 없기 때문에 저희 리서치에서는 어떤 이런 성적인 채팅이 일어나면은 그와 관계된 사람들을 다 프레데터라고 그렇게 정의를 하고 있습니다. 그래서 아까 보셨던 그런 채팅룸 화면을 보셨고요. 예를 들면은 이 위에도 잠깐 나왔지만은 그 실제 데이터를 본 결과 저 MSP 그러니까 무비스타 플래넷에서 그 성적 언어에 대한 리스트를 가지고 있어요. 하지만 그 리스트에 걸리는 경우는 잘 없습니다. 예를 보시면은 이 채팅 같은 경우에 그런 언행이 해브잇이에요. 그러니까 해브잇이란 단어가 이 사람들이 섹스란 말을 쓰면은 걸린다는 걸 알고 있기 때문에 그거를 우회해서 쓰는 방향을 취하고 있어요. 그래서 또 하나의 예를 보시면 섹스를 써도 그거를 한 알파벳을 한 단어에 하나씩 쓰는 거죠. 그러니까 이 회사에서는 오토매틱하게 디텍션을 하는 그 얼럴트 워드에 해당되면 바로 이렇게 딱 리포트를 하는 그런 시스템도 가지고 있지만 그것만 가지고는 이런 경우를 잡아내기가 힘들고요. 그래서 저희가 가지고 있는 데이터셋인데요. 이제 우선 한 60명 정도 되는 프레데터의 실제 그 챗을 한 3개월, 뭐 길게는 3개월 정도 모아놓은 그 데이터하고요. 그 다음에 일반적인 유저의 챗, 15분 동안 UK에서 있었던 챗을 그냥 동시다발적으로 일어나는 챗을 모아놓은 그런 데이터셋을 가지고 저희가 연구를 했고요. 그래서 이 부분부터는 약간 테크니컬해서 그냥 간단하게만 말씀을 드릴게요. 이제 우선은 저희가 전처리라는 것을 해요. 그러니까 그 AI 머신러닝 알고리즘에 넣기 전에 그 두 가지의 클래스를 만드는데 그 클래스는 하나는 프레데터, 하나는 난 프레데터 이렇게 해서 두 가지 클래스로 만들고요. 그 다음에 이 데이터를 특징 짓는 어떤 특징값을 추출을 한 다음에 그것을 기계 학습 알고리즘에 넣으면 그 기계 학습 알고리즘이 이게 지금 들어온 데이터가 어느 클래스에 속하는지 프레데터에 속하는지 난 프레데터에 속하는지를 이제 결정을 하게 됩니다. 그리고 이제 최종적으로 이제 새로운 데이터를 가지고 다시 테스트하는 과정을 거치는데요. 그래서 다른 부분은 뭐 특별한 것이 없이 그냥 일반적인 AI 그런 시스템을 따르기 때문에 여기서 특별한 부분은 전처리 부분이라고 할 수가 있겠어요. 그래서 전처리 부분에서 말씀드리고 싶은 것은 사람들의 어떤 매뉴얼 프로세싱이 생각보다 많이 일어난다라는 거예요. 그래서 이 데이터셋을 만드는데 왜냐하면 이게 그 프레데터 케이스에 속하는지 안 속하는지 알아야 되고 또 그 프레데터 실제 챗을 보면은 대부분은 그냥 일반적인 챗이에요. 그중에 일부만 그런 프레데이션에 해당되는 그런 내용이거든요. 그래서 그런 부분을 뽑아내기 위해서 상당히 매뉴얼 프로세싱이 많이 필요했다라는 거고요. 그래서 이런 특징값 같은 것을 뽑아서 저희가 실험을 해본 결과 여기 나와 있는 것은 머신러닝 알고리즘들이고요. 결과는 약 accuracy가 한 93% 정도 되는 정도로 괜찮은 결과를 얻었습니다. 그래서 이제 결론적으로는 AI 어떤 이런 기술을 이용해서 섹슈얼 프레데터를 디텍트 하는데 효과가 있다, 유용하다라는 말씀을 드리고 싶고요. 그런데 여기서 한 가지 그 지금 윤리와 관련된 어떤 컨선에 대해서 말씀을 드리자면은 첫 번째는 당연히 프라이버시 이슈가 있죠. 그리고 아까 말씀드린 것처럼 저희가 섹슈얼 프레데터를 정의할 때 서로 상호적인 거, 컨센슈얼한 거라고 하더라도 저희가 성적인 메시지가 있으면은 프레데터로 보기 때문에 그런 부분에 있어서는 더욱 프라이버시를 침해됐다고 할 수 있을 겁니다. 또 한 가지는요, 아까 보시는 바와 같이 매뉴얼 프리프로세싱 하는 부분에 있어서인데요. 이 매뉴얼 프리프로세싱을 하려면 그 섹슈얼하게 프레데이션이 있는 그런 덜티 텍스트를 여러 번 읽어야 돼요. 그래서 그 중에 어떤 부분이 해당되는지를 사람이 이렇게 체크를 해야 되거든요. 그랬을 때 그 작업을 하는 사람들에 대한 어떤 컨선이 개인적으로 있었어요. 그리고 더 이제 이것을 똑같은 내용을 다른 쪽에 더 이용할 수도 있겠죠. 예를 들면은 나와 정치적 견해가 다른 사람을 디텍트하기 위해서 쓴다면 아마 그런 경우도 가능할 겁니다. 그런 것들에 대한 컨선이 있었습니다. 그렇게 해서 이제 제가 했던 거는 어떤 이런 온라인 챗에서 그런 섹슈얼 프레데터를 디텍트하기 위한 그런 아주 콘크리트한 리서치를 프리젠트를 해드렸고요. 그 관련된 그 윤리적인 문제가 있었다라는 거를 말씀드리고 끝내도록 하겠습니다.
네. So next will be Matthew Stender. Please be ready.
Thanks, KS. Thanks, everybody. Good to be here. They say that the world is being eaten by software, and I think not before time we're now having a very broad debate about algorithms and about whether perhaps we have put too much trust in algorithms. It's time that we had exactly that debate. I'm a computer scientist. In first year computer science, I learned things about algorithms, about the limits of algorithms. And now I'm a mid-career privacy researcher and analyst. And I think that people have forgotten these fundamentals about algorithms. So I've got some concerns about that. We heard from Chris Ola, who has concrete problems about AI safety. I've got abstract problems about AI safety and algorithms that I want to talk about today. I'd like to help set some research agendas for a better understanding of algorithms, better expectations of algorithms, and therefore better preparedness by regulators and policymakers and consumers and the public and politicians and journalists who are writing about this stuff with a great deal of naivety. And I'm calling for more sophistication and I think more modesty on the part of technologists in particular. So the benchmark for intelligence has always been game playing. And one of the most important historical computer games was backgammon. I think in the late 1960s, a backgammon program for the first time beat the world champion of backgammon. Now, the most philosophically important thing about that was that the person that programmed the backgammon program did not play backgammon himself, had never played the game, took a simple set of rules, produced a program that beat the world champion. Now, nobody really took that seriously as intelligence, but of course when Deep Blue by IBM beat Garry Kasparov at chess, then that was dramatic, and I think it was Newsweek magazine said that this was the end of humanity. So that's a bit hysterical. But what we do as humans is that every now and again we change the rules of what defines intelligence. Now think about that for a minute and think about whether a computer intelligence is ever going to be able to change the rules that define its own intelligence. But that's what we do. Now, AlphaGo we've heard about a lot. Now, with the greatest respect to my new Korean friends, I know that this was a social catastrophe in this country, but I ask you to not take it too seriously because we're going to change the rules about intelligence again. But not only that, AlphaGo can't play chess. And I'm not going to get excited about artificial intelligence until Watson can drive a car, because I think that I could beat AlphaGo at chess. Now, the important thing about algorithms is that they are deterministic and they have a fixed set of inputs. The curious thing about algorithms, you know, we talk about the definition of ethics, but I was preparing for this talk and there's not a really good definition of algorithm either. But again, as a first-year computer scientist, I was taught that an algorithm is a repeatable set of instructions. It's like a recipe. And the most important thing when we compare algorithms with the human condition is that algorithms always operate on a fixed set of inputs, and they're completely deterministic. You can't surprise an algorithm, and that's what sets these things apart from the human condition. Now, there is this optimism about algorithms in society. What people don't understand and what we learned in first year computer science is that some problems do not have algorithmic solutions. Some very simply stated problems, like the traveling salesperson problem, but the halting problem in computer science, the most basic problem of all, can one computer tell if another computer is ever going to stop? There's no algorithmic solution for that. Now, there are many morals to that story, and again, that's a human thing, right? Telling morals and disagreeing about what a meaning is. But one of the meanings of the halting problem is that very, very simple problems can't be solved. And I put it to you that there is this hubris, or I think extreme arrogance actually, that we can solve any human problem like driving a car algorithmically. We are rushing headlong into some naive settings, and maybe policy settings, but we've heard that the Mercedes-Benz company have simply decided that their car is going to have to make a choice between killing the passenger or killing the person. Now, I don't want to make too many generalizations. I don't want to make too much of these academic problems, or the coffee table problems, or problems that we might have over a glass of wine. People can make too much of this. My point is that there is no simple way through these problems. And there is this, if you think about it, underlying AI, there is an optimism or an arrogance that the computers are going to be able to do what humans do. And the computers can't even do really simple things. So it's amazing that we actually are putting so much faith into a self-driving car, for example. That's why we have courts. Now, I'm not a lawyer, but I like lawyers. I've spent decades working with lawyers. And I've asked myself all the time, why do we have the law? We have the law because the world is imperfect. Moreover, we have the law because things are unpredictable. And court cases themselves are unpredictable, especially when they come down to matters of life and death. If you think about court reporting in the media, the reason why we have court reporting, the reason why we have courtroom dramas on TV is because the court process itself is unpredictable. And that is an amazing thing for a computer scientist. These very important life and death decisions are made unpredictably, not just over periods of time, but if you gave a self-driving car limitless time to make that decision about is it going to hit the kid or is it going to hit the dog, some of these problems are not reconcilable even in human lifetimes. So the important thing about the trolley problem, and I love it that I heard this today, I heard it for the first time in an audience, but this has worried me for months or years. My understanding of the trolley problem is that there is no answer to the trolley problem. And yet people are running around trying to predict what a self-driving car is going to do. That is not the point. The point of the trolley problem is that there is no answer. And yet computer scientists and technologists are building these things with a deep expectation, and I think that regulators have an expectation that the predictability of a self-driving car is going to be complete, that you can actually have a complete problem definition. And that's incredibly optimistic. So let's manage the expectations that we have. There are these simplistic assumptions about how computers work. We've already heard today about how so much knowledge comes from science fiction movies. But, you know, very serious, po-faced descriptions of things like facial recognition usually use these cartoon pictures. Now, a few years ago, this was a fairly sophisticated idea that a computer vision system would plot facial features and measure the separations and the angles and so on and so forth. It's not how they work anymore. Deep neural networks, back-propagating neural networks, don't work like that. In fact, we're not really sure how they do work. And I love it that Urs this morning said that there is this asymmetry between what the experts know and what the lay people know. I don't even know that the experts know this, because the point of deep neural networks, as they learn and as they propagate and as they rewire themselves, is that you can't predict how they work. Now, this is leading to some amazing and some really deeply unsettling failure modes. I think we've already heard about the terrible racist misidentification of photos that we saw on Flickr and Google Images a year or two ago. And so the response to that, of course, quite correctly, was that the millions and millions of images that are being used to train these algorithms are biased, and maybe there aren't enough ethnic minorities in the facial libraries. Maybe there's not enough cultural experience amongst the programmers, and there's certainly not enough cultural experience amongst the testers. So those issues got correct coverage in the media, but the deeper issue is, do we really know how these neural networks are behaving, and are they predictable in the way that we assume systems are relatively predictable when we frame safety regulations? When we frame a safety regulation, we do so with an intellectual framework for how we expect systems to fail. And these systems are failing in ways that are truly bizarre. The best example of all in the last couple of weeks, Carnegie Mellon, studying facial recognition, published a paper, and I've added it to the reading list. But believe it or not, you can fool some of these facial recognition algorithms with these very strange rainbow-coloured glasses. Now, the image in the bottom left is matched by a neural network facial recognition algorithm is matched against the actress on the right. And now what's happening there is that the neural network algorithm is looking at stuff that we're not looking at, and it's failing in ways that we can't predict. The Tesla crash. I'm not here to diagnose the Tesla crash, and that would be legally probably irresponsible to do so. I just want to say that Tesla itself advertises the fact that they use deep neural networks in their commercial systems. So some very quick questions. How would we interrogate a neural network when it fails? People say that self-driving cars are going to be 1,000 times safer than humans and the death toll will collapse. That may be true, but they are still going to lead to some very strange situations that we as human beings and as lawyers are going to want to go and interrogate. Now, when a neural network fails, it's going to be difficult to go into it. Well, just think about it. Can you ask it a plain English question or Korean question? The Tesla that ran into a person and killed them, you can't pull the car over and ask it, what did you see? I'm not even sure that you can go into event logs and figure out what it saw, because the way that a neural network works is that it has these deep layers of connections. It's not procedural. There's no line-by-line processing. There's no line-by-line audit log. So if we know as scientists and as philosophers that some problems don't have algorithmic solutions, is it ethical to proceed as if they do? And is it a problem, I think, if we know that these things are going to fail in unpredictable ways, is it ethical to proceed on the basis that there are unforeseeable harms? We know that these things are going to go wrong in unpredictable ways. So there are new types of failure modes coming up. A lot of human cognitive science, human psychology, was advanced by studying the sad ways that people's brains fail. And pathologies of the human brain has indicated the human condition and clinical conditions. I wonder whether we need a pathology of AI and start to study how these things are going wrong. So look, the future is bright. We've got to prepare for surprises. There's no algorithm for everything. You know, when you're preparing for a talk and there's a bit of interesting news, well, 2 days ago, an Uber in San Francisco, a self-driving Uber, appeared to run a red light and nearly hit a pedestrian on the right-hand side of that image, the pedestrian's about to walk out into the road. Now, when I'm teaching my kid to drive, I teach them, don't run red lights. But I didn't never said to them, don't run over the pedestrian, because humans know that. So the picture about the kid riding the bike, if you think about it, you don't teach a kid to ride a bike. You let them learn how to ride a bike. And I think that we are still learning about learning, and the idea that self-driving cars and artificial intelligence are naturally going to learn things, that's a naive assumption that we need to revisit. Whereas I say that the risks are very abstract and who knows what's going to happen. Thank you.
Okay, next up, he will speak on social impact, Matthew Stender, Proprietary AI versus Humanity.
Hello everyone, my name is Matthew Stender. It's an honor to be here with you today. Just before we begin, the original talk that I was going to give was altered a little bit when I watched a documentary about 20th century American art and the idea of actually the power and influence of an image really kind of jumped into my mind as an interesting place to kind of focus the talk that I'll be giving today. I just wanted to also say that this talk is the first time I'll be giving it, but it stems from some of my other research, a framework that I'm working on I call MIMICS, which deals with proprietary algorithms, and there's 6 influencing factors, monitoring, indexing, manipulation, interception, censoring, and siloing, also known as walled gardens. And as I've been thinking about this over the last year, kind of realized the more and more how, if we say that art imitates life, that technology mimics reality. And so with that, I came across an article this last week that kind of talked about the power of the digital image and the way in which that images are no longer actually perhaps for humans, but we're only see small glimpses of them. And after we see them on our phone, it doesn't mean that they've disappeared. It just means that they're no longer that our optical sensors, our eyeballs, can no longer pick them up. And so this was something that was written in the New Inquiry, and I thought it was quite powerful, kind of a reevaluation how images are actually as much for machines as they are for humans now. This got me thinking about the way in which that that scholars for a long time have had best practices for the ways in which that we deal with uncontacted tribes from Indonesia to the Amazon, and basically that we have realized that not everyone is in the same mode of development. If we think about or bring that to the current AI framework, we really lack best practices for bringing people who are not networked especially, but even that are kind of just using technology passively, for how to bring them into the technology fold. Now that so many images are recorded and processed and continuously processed by neural networks and put into machine learning and the ways in which that even deep learning now is doing things that we don't understand. But it was kind of interesting to think that we really just assume that all this technology is there, but perhaps it's time to step back and ask ourselves, what is in the power? What is in the power of an image? And how do we start then working towards a code of conduct or a best practice to bring people in the context of so many different proprietary AI structures? And many of these are market-driven, for-profit, even the 4 big AI players, along with Baidu, are really self-maximizing and all have different compelling interests. So I'm briefly today going to talk about 3 things: the way that machines see us, the way that we see each other through the lens of machines, and how we in turn then see machines. I'm using the word machine here abroad, but we focus on artificial intelligence and all its subsidiary components. Through thinking about this, the way that a lot of times that because these AI algorithms are to enhance product or service offerings through a capitalistic framework, we're being nudged and certain decisions are being induced from us. This really decreases, in my opinion, our capacity for self-determination, our agency, and sometimes even without our knowledge. Right, so we are being induced to buy things or to visit a place, and we are really not even consciously aware that we're making certain decisions. When it comes to other people, we, through our image and through this technology, in a lot of ways, I believe that we're at risk of having our identities co-opted by various systems without our knowledge, and each different platform that captures our image sees different things in that image. Depending on the number of data points and the metadata associated with that image, there's different stories for Microsoft, for Facebook, for Google. Uber now has a new AI labs. And the third part here is we're talking about the Sheen. There is no standard definition for AI. Somebody spoke earlier about, the previous speaker, Steve, said for algorithms, even as something of this, we don't have a standard definition. And so when we're talking about the subsidiary components of artificial intelligence, of machine learning, of neural networks, there's so many different components, it's difficult for us to even have a baseline conversation and mean the same thing when we're perhaps talking about different elements of quote-unquote artificial intelligence. And that's not even getting into general artificial intelligence as kind of a next layer in AI development. And so ultimately, what I'm concerned about is that the AI system in which we're in now, it's underwritten by different social contracts. Each different system that we use, we actually have a different relationship with that system. So I'm going to talk about a few things now going into agency, our ability to kind of exercise our free, our self-determination, our identity, how we are kind of self-constructed perception of us and others, and then also how this kind of ties into social contract. Because all of these major systems are not public goods, and they're not even operating perhaps in the public interest, operating under the auspices of profit maximization and market and increasing market shares. I think that Professor Zuba from Harvard, who has coined the term surveillance capitalism, has really gotten, this is a very powerful concept, and the way in which that a lot of these systems around us are meant to turn data into dollars. And really, if we think about it, how do these companies valued at billions and billions of dollars advertising as a primary revenue model for the companies that are building these AI systems, again, are creating capitalist and capitalistic machines. And then this then, naturally, then will and try to, these systems will then try to nudge us into consumption decisions, not necessarily Google trying to us to buy Google's shares, but the advertisers that are using Google as a service, and so Google will nudge us towards its preferred partners. Another aspect of this in agency and identity is the freedom of movement. And I think as AI really kind of starts to combine more with automated robotics, everything from manufacturing to self-driving cars, these things become much more intertwined. And our movement will be influenced. The example of if our Internet of Things connected toaster sees that we haven't eaten and it phones home to its parent company that has a data sharing agreement with Uber, and we actually, then Uber decides to give us a self-driving Uber that happens to be on the way to passing by a bunch of KFCs. This is when, in my mind, things get murky, and so I didn't even really want KFC, but since I'm here and the interconnected networks are driving my decisions, it's quite tricky to even be able to peer inside of these systems to understand what element of my agency influenced the system itself to get me to do what. This also then comes with the freedom of association. And this is another aspect of when we're being captured by whether it's CCTV cameras, people's phones, or other aspects of digital imaging. The optical processing systems are kind of almost this ghost in the machine that I may be having a face-to-face conversation with you, but that conversation is being picked up by a system, perhaps, that is reading that, is able to identify us because we have phones in our pockets, or it's able to use facial recognition technology. And we really have almost this kind of fly on the wall, or we have a third party that's part of this. And this also plays out, bottom photo is a photo I took at the Black Lives Matter protest in Oakland a few months ago, and there was three or four helicopters circling around all ahead during the event, and no one really knew, you know, if they had cameras or what, if there was, you know, facial recognition technology being employed. But at the same time, this freedom of association now has another element, and this is we really don't know who is listening and how. So for me, the passive surveillance is a new form of distributed governments, because every company has its own rationale. And as we've seen before in previous talks, the replication of bias. And I think this is dangerous, because it turns us, these systems see us not as who, but what. And so the identifiers are there. Another thing that I'm quite worried about is both from lethal autonomous weapons systems to new facial recognition technology, in which that we, you know, really risk our freedom as and liberty as individuals when we're caught up in these systems that maybe not have any oversight. And a couple more slides. As processing moves from the cloud to the device, I think this is also something that we need to be aware of. Facebook has launched their Cafe to Go, which now is being able to process things on our phone. And so we're actually now able to have harness great power on our device and not even need to use cloud servers. Because we can't see underlying technology, only it can see us. This is something that I think that we need to examine in the social contract. And speaking of the social contract, here's a few things that I'm worried about: the replication of a historical inequalities. And we've probably heard a lot of these things before, but even removal of humans as the primary decision-making force, and all of this in the context of the capitalistic machines. We perhaps need to think about some of the defining historical documents to see if these are what we want to predicate future development on, or if we actually say this is actually a new era. We're in uncharted territory, and thus we need to create our own new laws. Do we want to say the Hippocratic Oath of do no harm in medicine? Should this be a basis, or the idea of a Magna Carta being able to have a trial by jury? And so finally, just to recap, you know, our physical presence is being captured by these proprietary systems that use images to create inferences. They're continuously processing and derive conclusions. Some of the actions are captured, or the same action can be captured by multiple optical engines. And because of this, we're viewed with kind of piecemeal and stratified. My same action is seen by different AI systems as meaning different things. The lack of capacity to control for governance, for oversight, is not there. And because they're being more ingrained, it's affecting us politically, economically, and socially. And I think in the future, we really need to step back and say, what does balanced governance and ethics and oversight look like? And how do we want these things to play in with our long-term desired social order? Thank you.
Next up is Toshie Takahashi, Professor Toshie Takahashi, Robots on the Road to Tokyo Olympics 2020, Complexity and the Social Impact of AI in Japan.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Toshie Takahashi from Waseda University. I should begin by qualifying that my background is that of a media scholar trying to make sense of the exciting world of AI. It helps that I have been appointed to the Technology Advisory Committee of the Tokyo Organizing Committee of the Olympic and Paralympic Games 2020. After Rio, Japanese government and companies seriously began to discuss how they make the Tokyo Olympic Games innovative and sustainable. It is against this background that I shall talk about what is going on in terms of technologies in Japan and how can we understand its social impact. So my paper is entitled Robots on the Road to Tokyo Olympic 2020, Complexity and the Social Impact of AI in Japan. I'll briefly touch on my two ongoing projects. As there are still works in progress, I shall mostly be talking about the theoretical framework developed within the project for understanding the social impacts of AI. So how can we understand the social impact of AI robots? And the theoretical framework I use is an adaptation of my earlier model for understanding media audiences. I had called the complexity model of audiences earlier, and now I renamed it as a complexity model of communication in order to expand its scope and understand the social impact of AI robots in the smart age. The complexity model of audience was first developed in my PhD dissertation in media and communications at LSE in 2003. And it has been published later as a book, Audience Studies by Routledge in 2009. In this model, I shifted the paradigm from a linear to non-linear model, from active audience to everyday life and complexity, and from audience activity in audience engagement. And I'll skip the paradigm of complexity because we don't have enough time. So anyway, a particular calls for a human version of complexity theory. So I will provide an integrated framework for the demonstration of the complex system of individuals, social groups, and cultures, and the paths of dynamic interactions between these in terms of interactivity, self-organization, adaptivity, and the notion of the chaos, the edge of chaos, thus contributing to the idea of the human version of complex theory as Apadurai calls. So how it applies to human interaction with emerging technologies. I depicted three levels of complexity in order to simplify the model, but there are numerous complex systems that exist among the micro and macro levels, and each level is not discrete, but rather is intra and interconnected, and moreover, dynamically interacts with the others. So at the level of individuals, there are two types of interactivity, intrapersonal and interpersonal. In the smart age, we have both more interaction with things such as robots and more transnational interaction via multi-language voice translation systems. I'll look at these two changes in the smart age from my two ongoing projects later. Adaptivity describes the dynamics of the processes of self-creation and of individuals' relationships with their external environment, such as institutions and the new communication technologies, and it shows how the external environment in turn feeds back into self-creation. In the smart age, there are three major powers in macro level: power from national level, global level, and the revolution of communication technology. I view the relationships between individuals and the macro as complex, dynamic, and sometimes unpredictable, and as the site of dynamic interactions among complex systems, including individuals, families, social groups, communities, and cultures. This collection of complex systems is an undergoing constant dynamic interaction such that the micro, macro, and every level in between are reflexive, feeding back into each other. So this is a CG image of my model. And I skip some part. The complexity model of communication is not a linear, but a non-linear model. Therefore, it shows neither one way of power from macro level, such as institutions, nor power from micro level, such as people's agency or empowerment. The aim of this model is to show the dynamic interaction of micro level phenomena, macro-level phenomena, and all the phenomena in between, thereby demonstrating the complexity of culture. So now I talk about the case of Japan in smart age. In macro-level, Ministry of Internal Affairs and Communications of Japan announced the Smart Japan ICT Strategy in June 2014. Their mission is to the most active country in the world. And the action is realizing the world's most advanced ICT environment for Tokyo 2020 Olympic and Paralympic Games. How this power from national level will it impact on Japanese people in micro level? At this juncture, I would like to introduce my ongoing two projects as they are aimed at answering such a question. The first one is global self-creation, and the second one is youth and robots. And Ministry of Internal Affairs and Communications of Japan have promoted global communication projects in their Smart Japan ICT strategy. This is also the first project out of nine scientific and technology projects for Tokyo Olympic 2020 by Japanese government. Let us watch a clip from the video of science, technology, and innovation which Japanese government created for their promotion for Tokyo Olympic 2020.
Based on its policy that science, technology, and innovation are major forces of worldwide advancement, the Japanese government will showcase the achievements of Japan's science, technology, and innovation at the Tokyo 2020 Olympic and Paralympic Games. The Japanese government is promoting nine scientific and technical innovations. Now, let us introduce to you the nine projects.
I will just show you the first one.
Please take me to the Square Hotel in Shibuya.
Square Hotel Shibuya made onegai shimasu.
Wakarimashita.
Okay.
Kaigai kara stress-free easy guidance for visitors from abroad. Remove the language barrier and speak with anyone.
Por favor, dígame el camino para ir con el coche del bebé.
With the best information available whenever you need it, you're free to enjoy the town. Easy guidance makes it possible to enjoy sightseeing and sporting events more than ever.
Please form a single line.
请排成一下. กรุณาต่อแถวเป็นแถวเดียว.
What can I do for you today?
I have a stomach ache.
이 블록은 어디입니까?
저쪽입니다.
We strive for a city that offers stress-free communication and travel. For a society where everyone can play a leading role.
Okay, Voistra is a multi-language voice translation system which has been developed since 1986. They began to use AI to analyze mass amounts of web pages and social media from diversified perspectives over 10 years. And Asterisk, they also create Asterisk, which is a team of Japanese companies to bring Voistra into society in many different scenes, such as public transportation, hospitals, taxi, and so on. They have received many feedbacks on Voistra from users, and this feedback loop among users and scientists and AI has been improving Voistra dramatically. I've been interviewing top computer scientists and neuroscientists who created Voistra and are specialists of AI. I also interviewed those company, but I don't give an example because I don't have time. So I moved on the next project. And my second project is youth and robots.
I'll show you a
short.
Here, they're everywhere. Who you ask? Maybe it's more of a what.
Today, current local will be rain.
Machines of all kinds. An exhaustive number of vending machines.
It's more than a way to shop. It's the new bar, it's the new waitress, and it's the evening's entertainment, literally. They're intelligent too, robots.
I'd really like to try a hamburger someday. Haha.
With personality and purpose, moving beyond the fun and the trendy, many Japanese scientists say a robotics revolution is underway. Some experts predict within just a decade or two, nearly half of the jobs in Japan could be done by robots. A practical answer, perhaps, to a shrinking and aging population, with 1 in 4 Japanese over age 65. Actually seems to work in Japan. In America, one of Japan's leading robotics...
Android. I'm using this Android for giving a lecture here. You know, usually I'm in Osaka University, but I can access to the internet and teleport this guy.
So you hold meetings using your twin. People sit and listen to you teach.
So he's one of the famous
with the robot.
Yeah.
Creators.
Geminoid Ishiguro's robotic doppelganger has traveled the world. Controlled remotely, a microphone captures his voice and a camera tracks his facial movements. So when the operator tilts his head, Geminoid follows. You feel like that, you know, people will become people will get accustomed to this. People will get used to this.
Mm-hmm. I think so. I think so.
Yeah. It's as much a study in humans as it is in robots, questioning fundamentally what makes a human human. Dr. Hiroshi believes the more that his androids resemble us, from the physical to the mental, the more likely they'll be accepted by us. She is your brand new creation.
Yes.
And she has artificial intelligence. So why? How is that different from previous androids?
She can have some conversational functions, and she can understand the human voice, and according to the pre-programmed scenarios, she can, you know, talk with the people.
You just met Erica. She's designed to be a 23-year-old woman. And in person, she's, well, surprisingly attractive, if you can say that about a robot. So what role do you envision Erica playing in our future society?
I think she can be a receptionist and the companions. She can do the many things for us.
How many years before we see Erica?
Soon, I think.
I guess I had to give it a go.
Hello, my name is Erica. May I ask your name?
My name is Will.
It's nice to meet you, Will. Let's learn a little about each other.
Okay, so in CNN video, we have just seen Professor Ishiguro and who creates androids, and I have visited his lab and talked with Erica, the brand new android which can communicate with people by using AI. So I also doing my research on young people and robots, and I have asked 225 young people to create their robot which they want to have in their everyday life. And I hope we can actually create a robot together which makes people happier in future. Japan is the fastest aging society in the world, and its companies and scientists are creating a lot of robots in response to this demographic fact. More than ever, I believe we need more discussions about living with robots in the future. So as I mentioned earlier, the two projects are ongoing, and I hope to share more about them another time. I will investigate how intercultural interaction and transnational connectivity have increased from global self-creation project. I will also investigate how interpersonal interaction with things and intercultural interaction have increased from youth and robots, and what kind of social impact they will have, and what kind of new cultures they will create. So this is my conclusion. As the complexity model of communication shows, social impact of AI can be understood not only from policies and strategies of government, companies, and other institutions, but also from people's engagement with new technologies. We are speeding into a brave new world where the complexities of human interactions with smart technologies and robots have the potential of hurling us towards the edge of chaos, so to speak. One question I have in mind is simply this. So what can we learn one of the new cultures that may emerge? Thank you very much.
Yes, Sara Watson, AI story so far.
So it's funny that I should pull up Wilson instead of Watson. I just wanted to state for the record that I have no relation to the Jeopardy champion supercomputer, though my name is Watson. So obviously, all of the discussion about the subject of AI is a very complex topic. Today, I want to talk a little bit about the stories we use to explain some of our concerns, especially in the context of the kind of popular consciousness. So stories are generally the way that we try to make meaning and understanding in the world. And generally, these stories are very portable, and they're very compact ways of trying to understand things. So they do have a lot of impact and kind of shaping of the conversation on a large scale. And I think it's important that has come up a lot today. Erz talked about it. Peter talked about sci-fi influencing the kind of stories that we talk about. And it also came up in the context of it being a uniquely human skill. So I think it's important to take a closer look at what these stories are that we keep telling about AI and its concerns, and to try to do a little bit more of a close reading of why they're not working and what we could do, what kind of stories we could be telling instead that would be more productive. So obviously the most prominent stories have a certain theme, right? In Kubrick's 2001, HAL 9000 is the comm assistant who shuts Dave out of the system. And in Terminator, the AI defense system Skynet becomes self-aware and initiates a nuclear holocaust to decimate the human race. And in Ex Machina, the sex robot becomes self-aware, and she passes the new Turing test to convince a human to help her by empathizing with her to help her escape. So all of these stories tend to be following this kind of construct, the man versus machine construct. And this is just one type of narrative conflict if we think about it from a storytelling perspective. Narrative conflict is basically the foundation of storytelling, right? There's an inherent incompatibility between characters or forces in the story, and that's kind of what drives the story forward. And I think these become especially clear when we're talking about stories that help us understand our relationship to technology. There's also the fact that we could be thinking a little bit more about not man versus machine stories, but rather man versus society stories, especially when we're talking about the concerns about technology in society. So it's less about our relationship to the technology itself and it being this combative conflict between our ability to use it or understand it, but rather the society that actually implements the technology and puts it into practice and the kind of social constructs that push that forward. So in the context of Minority Report, which often comes up in this AI discussion, obviously the technology is interesting and kind of almost mythological in the sense that it's using these precogs as energy in predicting activity. But it's really a central conflict about man versus the state and the state that is using this technology to make decisions about pre-crime. So obviously, I think these stories, as we've all talked about today, are very important, and they do have a certain cultural capital and weight, and they end up being these narratives that we rely on as shorthands. Terminator and Minority Report in particular seem to help us describe our deepest fears about what is possible when we're talking about technology. But when we use them as shorthands, especially in policy conversations, it's easy to forget the details of these stories to actually understand what's going on. And in the context of Elon Musk's arguments about AI, he's saying, with artificial intelligence, we are summoning the demon. He's literally talking about the most primordial narrative conflict between good and evil, right? But that's arguably oversimplifying the entire problem in itself. And that's where we end up running the risk of these narrative fallacies. So all these shorthands are useful in the sense that they kind of point to some general concern, but again, they're oversimplifying, they're sensationalizing, they're largely Western and coming from Hollywood. So if we're worried about the future of AI or the future of discussions about what society is going to do about AI, we're running the risk of focusing too much on these fallacies. Even though those tend to be the ones we're using to talk about the heuristic for decision making, especially in the popular consciousness. And I would argue that looking at those narratives are one of the reasons that we start to see things like the partnership on artificial intelligence to benefit people and society, which is the conglomeration between Facebook and Google and Amazon, IBM, Microsoft. They're addressing the fact that these narratives are scary and see the need to get ahead of that fear because of all the kind of popular discourse around what our AI concerns really are. So I would just argue that this kind of principal statement that is part of their agreement or their kind of partnership, suggesting that it's important for the operation of AI systems to be understandable and interpretable by people for purposes of explaining the technology. And so I think in this case, they're arguing not just for engineers to be able to understand the technology, but rather that that can be also conveyed to the rest of society. But I think when we focus on these narratives, they are really talking about those current fears about the future, and often not really focusing on the present concerns of how these technologies are actually being implemented already. And I think this has been largely discussed, I think, in the Ryan Callow and Kate Crawford piece that was referenced earlier today, but that we're not really talking about the concrete of our current concerns. And also, they don't really, they address the fear and they address the concern about what's possible, but they don't actually provide an alternative to what should happen instead. They don't provide a solution to, say, providing transparency or oversight to these technological systems. So given that these stories that we have are pretty limited, they're not giving us any good models for what transparency or accountability would look like, I'm starting to wonder if there's something useful that we can learn about storytelling in AI as we try to discuss these kind of social and ethical questions. So I want to focus a little bit more on, less on the kind of conflict, but rather, and less machine versus man, but more man with machine. So I want to focus a little bit on some other elements of storytelling that we can actually think through these questions and concerns with. I think we can use them as tools for thinking. So when we're talking about the kinds of personalities of the AIs that we're interacting with, I think there's a lot we can learn from thinking through what character development looks like in storytelling. What's the voice of these characters? How do we understand what they're motivated by, what they're capable of? I think spending a little bit more time thinking about who's deciding what these characters look like and how we interact with them can be important. And a lot of that is about learning how users are supposed to interact with these systems. We can also spend some time thinking about first-person narratives of AI. If we want to understand what it's like to be an AI, to understand AI subjectivity, I think there are going to be more ways of trying to show humans the ways that these networks work. So this is just one example of kind of showing the outlines of machine vision and how that the kind of processing involved with the iterative process. And I think Deep Dream came up in Google's presentation as another way of trying to understand what the machine is doing and what it's processing. Of course, this is so abstract and so weird, so I think what's useful in this case is to think about, in terms of storytelling, the non-linear narrative, the things that are not easy to follow. In an almost postmodern sense or an impressionistic sense, what are the weird possibilities of how these things work? And images like this kind of reiterate that unintelligibility in a perhaps useful way, and to suggest that, you know, the logic and narrative of AIs is not straightforward, it's non-linear. And as we've seen in the popular Westworld going on right now, a lot of the conflict in that show is largely about the hosts, the robots, becoming aware of their narratives and understanding the narrative constraint that is the kind of loop pressure that's been put on them. And so I think this even illustrates just how important narrative awareness in autonomy and sentience is actually in the case of their lives. So I was meant to talk a little bit in the context of transparency, but I think in the context of the social effects, it touches on the same issue. And when we're talking about transparency itself as a value is actually kind of a metaphor in itself. So again, drawing on the kind of literary approach to understanding these desires even. So when we're talking about transparency in AI, what are we really trying to make transparent? Transparency literally means to make something clear so that you can see through to the other side. In the process of AI, if we're talking about, you know, is it just the inputs and the outputs that we're trying to make transparent? The design intent? Are we talking about legibility, interpretability, accountability? All of these things kind of come up into this vague desire for transparency. And I would argue that calls for transparency are largely a rhetorical gesture towards accountability and auditing and governance, and often leave it up to the position of the technology owner to have ownership over making their process transparent, but usually on their terms rather than on a kind of imposed set of terms. So lastly, I want to focus maybe instead of legibility and intelligibility and interpretability to focus on close reading. In the context of AI, we don't often have an ability to really understand precisely what's happening in the process, but we can always look at the inputs and the outputs. So I kind of compare this to the idea of focusing on authorial intent. In literature, we've stopped kind of paying attention to authorial intent because there's not so much you can understand about what an author's aim was in writing the piece that they wrote, but we do have the ability to close read the text that we have in front of us, and we also have the ability to look at their biographical information as an input. But it's trying to link the two seems to have been proven as a not interesting exercise. And lastly, I want to push towards looking to local stories and more diverse sets of stories to try to understand our concerns. Often we talk about fables and parables, myths and folklore as a way of expressing local values and local ethics. I think especially in the context of parables and fables, those stories are very literally designed to convey values to, especially to children. So I, in Korea, I was looking to, this is my last slide. Do you want the local context or no? Okay. So in Korea, the haitai is the unicorn lion, known as the mythical beast, and is apparently the symbol for Seoul. This is also coming from Chinese history. But I think what's interesting here is the idea that this animal is capable of, has a righteous temperament and knows who is right and makes a judgment and kind of rams the person who is wrong. And so it is a symbol of justice and law, but it is also kind of a black box experience, right? That it's not capable of explaining necessarily who is right and who is wrong. And so even just this one kind of example as a different path towards trying to understand what the concerns are and the values are, I know that there are probably 100 different ways of kind of applying even just this one example to the context of AI, but I just want to push people to think a little bit more creatively about what touch points we look to and trying to disrupt what those dominant narratives are and replace them with more productive narratives. So, thank you.
Okay, any questions, comments from the audience or among the panelists? I prepared some. Was there a question? Okay. Well, I prepared some questions. Question for Steve. You said there are some problems that just don't have answers, and you refer to the trolley problem. But my understanding of the trolley problem is that in the problem itself, it's okay to turn the car to save five people at the expense of killing one. It's okay to do that. So there is an answer there. But the problem is when you compare it to other situations, like killing one healthy person and harvest his organs to do transplant for five dying patients, that is not okay. So that problem also has an answer. But the dilemma is, what's the difference between the two situations? So we don't know why, but we seem to have an answer for these problems. It's just that we don't know why, and my understanding is that it is because we do not really clearly understand what's going through our minds when we are saying it's okay to kill one instead of five, but it's not okay to kill one patient and harvest his organs to save five dying patients. So some people call for better algorithmic understanding of our ethical evaluation of things. Wanted to hear your response to that.
Look, the truth of the trolley problem is that it has answers that vary depending on what philosophical frame you want to adopt. So if you want to be utilitarian, and if you know everything, so you know that the single person is not a biochemist who has the solution for cancer, and you know that those five people aren't going to die tomorrow anyway, if you have perfect knowledge, and then you sit down and say, if we're utilitarians, then we'll get the answer. But it's inconceivable that any AI can work like that, because these decisions are made by communities. I think that what's interesting too is to reflect on that old saying that says reasonable people can disagree about X, Y, Z. And what that means is that people will accept the other argument if you're willing to change your philosophical frame or your ethical frame. So I think the answer for me is still that there is no algorithmic solution to that. We could keep talking about this all night, and we would keep saying, what if? What about that? We keep adding inputs, and the problem's unbounded. Now, when you think about really interesting problems, trolley problems is academic, but there are life and death issues around euthanasia and around abortion and around death penalty. These problems are deeply human, deeply social. We may never resolve. You may never get global agreement on that. So my only point is to characterise that there are human conditions that are not solvable algorithmically. And yet, a Mercedes-Benz manager can say with a straight face, well, of course, our algorithm is going to save the life of the passengers instead of the people on the road. I don't even know how you could actually write code that expresses that statement. I don't think it could be done with any sense of actual responsibility or closure. It's a pretty wild problem. That's assuming that the software works. You know, we've got 10 million lines of code, it's not going to work.
Sure.
I think it's also like worth noting that different engineers that are designing these systems come from different cultural backgrounds. Google's, you know, the underlying DNA, if you will, of Google's AI might be fundamentally different than Baidu. That a Confucianistic, collectivistic, social harmony-based identity might bring about a different sort of AI DNA, if we will, from a kind of a techno-libertarian Silicon Valley DNA. And I think there's also some cultural things, even the idea of, are there certain things that a human can do in life in which the state should retain the capacity to take away that life, kind of the death penalty. But if we're talking about lethal autonomous weapons systems, this is also something different. Some people may have a different perception of, like, well, humans should never even take away a life, much less machines. And so I think it's important that we understand that people have different cultural contexts in which these systems are designed from. And I think this idea of distributed governance kind of gets a little to that, in which that we're not, there's not an even playing field for all these technologies that we're discussing.
Just to add to that, if you remember from the movie Ex Machina, does anyone remember where did the computer guru source the content of intelligence that he built into the robots there? Search engines, yes. So through search engine, he wanted to harvest the diversity that you are talking about, all the differences between views. So that, you know, even that is through algorithm that, you know, so there's so much data coming through search engines, and even that is through algorithm that diversity is harvested. Yes.
I have a question for Professor Takahashi about the Japan's robotics projects for the Tokyo Olympics in 2020. I was interested in hearing about that, partly because Korea is doing a very, I guess, very similar project for 2018 Winter Olympics. Robotics projects are going on. I think they are doing the similar things like translation services and other robot service or receptionist, things like that. I'm not involved with that, but that's what I hear. So I completely understand why they choose Olympic Games for that, with this publicity event, that's great. But then it occurs to me that it's a little strange that the, Olympics is one of those occasions when the world attention is given to the human body, the physical human body, human strength and human agency, right? This full display of humanity there, physicality. But then the robotics translators, machine translators, all these non-human machines are also put to the front of the event. So I think the contrast is something interesting to think about. I don't know how the Japanese scholars or the public are talking about these using Olympics for robotics display like that. So if you have any ideas about that.
Thank you for your questions. I think it's very good point. And we have only 4 years, and it's impossible for Japanese people, I mean, everybody who can speak Japanese, Taiwanese, Chinese, you know, Koreans, all languages. And also, do you remember that when Japan win that game, they said omotenashi, that we tried to welcome, I mean, all non-Japanese people, and we want to do something, you know, hospitality, but it's so hard if we don't understand the language, and also, and then we tried to combine the human, I mean, how can, we try to use the technologies to complement to human beings' skill. So, and also like we talk about, when we talk about the smart age or smart society, it's not like internet and people, but more like together, not cyber, not virtual world and not real world. It's coming together like social media. So in that sense, for the Tokyo Olympic also, we tried to not human, you know, human, human-human, but also we tried to use the technologies to help human and try to give a path to the future world, because our society is becoming aging. Our society is the decline of birth rate, and so in that sense, we also think about how can we use a robot or AI to help us for lifelong living or something like that.
Okay, any other question?
Yes, I have a question. Well, my question is quite general, so it's not to a particular presenter. Everything that's been said today, I think, is based on the premise that there is a fundamental difference between AI and human beings. But I think there will come a time, there will be a moment when the line will blur between AI and human beings. And I think that will be particularly important for future generations, when children will grow up in a situation where AI is so prevalent and dominant in our society that it will be difficult for them to distinguish between AI and human beings. And my question is the scientific community and the academia somehow preparing for such a moment, for such a phenomenon? This, of course, is a very abstract question, but it's something that is quite interesting for me. Thank you.
We'll take one more question, and then... okay, actually, Sara wanted... I think you wanted to speak first.
Another question, yeah. If I can just... and this was... I'm sorry, ma'am, I forget your name. It was for the games and online sexual abuse in games.
Professor Cheong, yeah.
The online... Do you feel that there are... It's my feeling is that you, as a woman, might have a different cultural experience, having dealt with harassment and sexual harassment in particular. Do you feel that some of the problems that we're looking to solve now, how important is it to have empathy and experience inside of a kind of the interpersonal, an interpersonal connection to these issues that we work on? Do you feel that the research you do, your empathy from your gender gives you additional insight that perhaps your male counterparts could not really kind of grasp?
Okay, good question. Sara, why don't you answer? You wanted to answer the question from the audience, right?
Well, I think it makes more sense to start there.
Okay, all right.
Okay. So when I worked for the project, I had two students, master female students, and they volunteered to solve the problem because they believe that that's very important for the young girls. And one of them, one of the two female students, she was pregnant at the time. So she thought that she will make the society better by working on that project. So I was worried about that they had to read all the sexual dirty text while she was pregnant. So I asked her several times, is it okay? And she said, yeah, it's not fun, but I think I can, I feel very responsible for it. And then I want to make a better one. So that's why I'm keep working on it. So I think maybe if male student worked on the project, they may check. I mean, I said in my presentation, I said that they had to pick who is a sexual predator. And then if male students have worked on it, they may check some other persons as a predator than the female students have done. So they may check maybe less number of person as a predator compared with the ones that female students did. Does that answer your question?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
So your question actually made me think of what the bedtime story would look like for teaching our kids about how to interact with AIs or how to recognize an AI. And I tried to picture like the Blade Runner version of a children's story to say, you know, how to tell if you're interacting with an AI or not. But I think that's a productive way of hypothesizing and kind of speculating what that interaction might look like, to have to explain to children where those differences are, or whether those differences will even matter to articulate.
Well, thank you. Thank you for, let's give a round of applause to the panelists and to the audience for taking time.